It's so expensive. I don't want to stroke my kettle. If I have to break out a manual to use a kettle, have you made it too complicated? Today, we're going to look at temperature-controlled electric gooseneck kettles, which is a easy, flows off the tongue sentence. And I thought it'd be quite a simple video. I thought, you know, I should do more comparisons and maybe that's not going to be too much work. And I was wrong. How do you compare these things? How do you not turn it into some sort of weird subjective thing? You need objective testing. And that took us to some interesting places. But first, before we get into how we tested them, let's look at what's on the bench, their price and their kind of milliliter capacity. It's just gonna be a metric today. No surprises to anyone. So starting over here with the cheapest of the kettles, this is the Diguo. It's not a brand I'm familiar with. It was on Amazon. It was £53 and it has a 700 milliliter capacity. Next up is a little bit more expensive. It's the Dualit. Now this is £85 with an 800 milliliter capacity. Here we've got the Timemore. This is more expensive again at £95 with only a 600 milliliter capacity. Here we have the Felicita Square. Big jump in price up to £125. And again, just a 700 milliliter capacity. Here we have the Bonavita. This is £90 and has a 1 liter capacity. Next to it is the Brewista. And this is their latest kettle. This has a 1.2 liter capacity and is £100. Now, this feels a little unfair. I paid £195 for the Hario electric Buono kettle. I have seen it cheaper in Europe, but in the UK it's quite expensive. It has an 800 milliliter capacity. And last up is the fellow Stagg EKG, coming in at £150 in the UK and 900 milliliters in capacity. So a range of sizes and prices, and I had to work out how do you test these in an objective manner. And the first thing I wanted to do was do a kind of heating efficiency speed test. And actually we did it twice. So for the first test, we put 500 grams of room temperature water, which was at 22 degrees Celsius. And we set the kettles to 95 degrees Celsius because they're all temp controlled. And we checked how long it would take them to get up to temperature. Now, they all have different wattages. And that's kind of important here, right? A kettle that has a higher wattage will work quicker. So we had to kind of factor that in. So I made a graph. It's a pretty simple graph. And it shows you along the bottom is the wattage, how powerful a kettle might be, and up the side, how long it took to reach its target temperature. And the line here on the chart is the kind of theoretical maximum speed for that wattage, right? You can do the maths. It's relatively easy to calculate how long it should take with a fixed wattage to heat a fixed amount of water from a fixed temperature to a desired end temperature. It's not too complicated. I can do it. And then we can see how the various kettles did. Now, the question for me was, would the kettle be very careful and quite slow and kind of pushing the temperature up as it got close to its target temperature? Would it go really quickly and just do a little bit at the end? What was the timing like? So as you look at the chart, you'll see the kettles, the further they are directly above that line, then the slower they were for the power that they had. And there were a couple of standouts that were a bit slower than I expected, and one that sort of cheated. Now, during all of this, they were plugged into one of these. It's a really cheap sort of socket meter that let me see what their actual wattage draw was. Now, the voltage in the studio is higher than is typically rated. We're at about 245 volts, which is why, you know, there was a kind of big bump in wattage from the kettles versus what they sort of listed as pulling. So in most cases, they were pulling more than sort of 10%, you know, which is kind of crazy, than the listed wattage. So that's just important to note. What you could also then see was how the kettles were using power. Now the Dualit was interesting because it sort of ran on full power and then it seemed to drop to exactly half power. Like there's two separate elements here that it runs one or both, depending on how much heat it needs. But it turned out to be pretty slow. So it sort of disengaged one of the two elements as it got close and then sort of pulsed its way there. But it was actually quite a slow kettle. And this one here, the Timemore, was also quite slow, which was interesting. Just really gentle, just really took its time to sort of push its way very slowly to the required temperature. The Felicita, however, just kind of cheated. Like it just overshot quite a lot. It peaked at sort of 97, 98 when I set it to 95. It was very quick, but it just ran the power until 95 and then switched off. And you know, the additional residual energy inside the element continued to heat the water and there was a decent amount of overshoot. So a disappointing result for the Felicita. Aside from that, they were kind of much of a muchness, right? Like they were pretty similar in their kind of timings given their respective wattages. Then I wanted to do a different heating test, hopefully a simpler one. I just wanted them to boil. And if they're smart, right? If they're supposed to be smart kettles, they should know that if I just want boiling, they can just put the element into go until it hits boiling point, like a regular, normal, kind of cheap kettle does. And some of them worked that out, and some of them didn't. The Dualit, again, was pretty slow. It clicked into that half element power, or that sort of 600 watt power supply kind of range, as it got close, and therefore took quite a long time to boil. The Timemore was extremely nervous to get close to boiling point, and really, really, really took its time. This was really quite slow to get where it needed to go, which was interesting and kind of a surprise. Now, in some cases, and we can take this kettle here, the Brewista, this just has a button that is boil, just go, and that's exactly what it does. So this performed really well. It was very quick, unsurprisingly, because it just did what it was supposed to do. The Hario Buono just seemed to be very quick to boil. There was no messing around. It just went straight to 100 and clicked off. And then, yes, also the fellow Stagg. Again, it tries to be a little clever and just take you very slowly, very accurately to 100. So this was also a pretty slow kettle in that regard. I know this was a bit nerdy, but if you think about the time it takes to get where you need to go every single morning, assuming you brew just once a day, then time adds up. It's kind of important. And again, how a kettle gets to boiling point is important to me because kettles have other uses. You're not just going to do a pour over if you've bought an electric kettle. You might have other applications. You might want to make tea, you might want to make a French press or another kind of immersion brew that doesn't need a slow pour of water. And you might want to go straight to boiling and then be able to pour quite quickly. Now, how these pour, we'll get to in a minute, and it is really genuinely very interesting. But what I also wanted to check first was the kind of maximum flow rate that these spouts let you produce. If you want to make tea, if you want to make a French press, then you would want the water to come out actually pretty quickly. And there's really kind of two groupings here of the kettles. Five of them produced quite a high flow rate, right? In the 40 plus mils per second, that would let you do a sort of 10, 12 second pour for half a liter. Fine, totally fine. However, three of the kettles just poured too slowly for me to recommend them for uses outside of pour over brewing. And so the three slow kettles are the Diguo. This maxed out at 24 milliliters per second, which is pretty slow. If we think about that half liter fill, that is a 20 second pour, not hugely convenient. A little bit quicker, but still too slow, was the Timemore, which was 27 mils per second. Just a bit too slow for me for multiple applications. And by far the slowest was the Fellow. That maxed out at 17 grams per second, which is just too slow. If you think about how long that takes to fill a half liter French press, that's just an awkwardly long time. It's just an irritatingly long time to just, you just want the water out. I don't want to own two kettles. I don't want to have two kettles in my kitchen. It doesn't make sense. If you want to make tea, if you want to make, I don't know, like instant ramen or something, something quick, having a separate kettle for that? No. You just really would need a kettle like this if you're only going to be brewing pour over coffee and really nothing else that requires a kettle. And I think that's worth talking about. But I did say we talk about pouring. And then this is where things get really interesting. The challenge for me was, how do you find a way of objectively measuring the quality of the pour? How does the water fall from the sort of spout of that gooseneck? Now, thankfully, Jonathan Gagnier recently published a very interesting little book. It's called The Physics of Filter Coffee. This isn't a paid promotion, and there's no affiliate link down below. But if you're interested in this kind of stuff, I would strongly recommend checking it out. And he has an entire chapter on the sort of flow from a pouring kettle. And this was most definitely the inspiration for this section of the video. In the book, Jonathan talks about what's called breakup length. I'm going to really simplify here. There's a lot more detail if you're interested in it. But essentially, at what point in the stream does it go from a sort of steady, complete stream and then begin to kind of bead into droplets? Now, you might have seen things like the kind of viral video that went down of like how well made some Chinese teapots were in the way that they pour. I'll show you that just here. It's kind of interesting to see like a very bad kettle. You see that beading happen quite early. With an exceptionally good kettle, it just almost never happens. But what we decided to do was pour all of these kettles at a fixed flow rate, at a fixed height, and measure, using slow motion, at what point those streams began to bead. And first we did that at 10 mils per second, and I'll show you that right now. And as you look at it, you can see there's some interesting variation in the sort of the way that the streams are breaking up. For example, the Diguo isn't doing very well. The stream's breaking up actually relatively early on in terms of height, whereas something like the Hario Buono is doing pretty well. You can see that stream remains intact a lot longer in the pour. And I'll kind of put the breakup lengths on screen so you can sort of see the variation here. You could argue exactly how long that breakup length is, but roughly speaking, these are the kind of differences between them. But during the testing, we thought 10 mils per second maybe wasn't entirely fair. You know, you don't often use that rapid of a flow rate when you're pouring a pour over. So we tested again at 5 milliliters per second or 5 grams per second. Again, the results are super, super interesting. And you can see at some of the slower pour rates, Kettles, again, like the Hario Buono, does really well. That stream remains extremely complete for quite a long time. You know, it's a long length of unbroken water, which is, you know, I think a solid endorsement of the quality of its spout. Again, you know, the lengths, approximate lengths of breakups are here on the screen if you want to have a kind of rough comparison for each of the kettles that are labeled at the bottom. Now, in reading the chapter in Jonathan's book, you can understand why this is important. The quality or the nature of the stream of water when it hits the bed, the brewing bed, really impacts the nature of agitation and extraction. And to better illustrate this, we brewed some coffee until it had nothing left to give, and then we put it in a transparent V60, and you can see when a slow but steady stream of water hits the bed, that column of water penetrates right to the bottom of the bed and agitates the coffee underneath it extremely effectively. However, once that water starts to bead and turn to droplets, it's much less effective at agitating the coffee in the bed. This is not the point at which we say this is the right way to agitate coffee and this is the wrong way. It's really about control and optionality and understanding these things, understanding pour heights, understanding how you want to agitate your coffee consistently. But it seemed to be a kind of beautiful, interesting, fun way to compare the qualities of each of the spouts. Now we're going to get into some more subjective territory. I'm going to use each one. I'm going to heat up the water, pour a little bit, just talk through the experience of using it, the UX, UI, the features, the functions on the kettles, one by one, and let you know what I think. So the Diguo. Some pretty simple features, but what you'd expect from a temp-controlled kettle. An on-off button, a temperature set button, and that will cycle through various temperatures, but you can get close to where you want to go and use the plus and minus. And once you've let it set for a little bit, it'll click on, and the little light that says work comes on, which I quite like that. There is, of course, a hold button that will keep it holding at your desired temperature for a while, but let's just heat it up and pour some water. A little beep to let me know it's done, and let's make coffee. Now, the pouring experience with this thing, I'm not a huge fan. We already know that the spout isn't superb. The handle, actually, I really dislike it. It's at a weird angle. The balance of the whole thing feels off, and it just is quite uncomfortable to hold, actually, in comparison to a bunch of the other kettles. So if I own this, I'd probably want to bend the shape of this to bring it a little bit more sort of down in line. So next up is the Dualit. I quite like the fit, the finish of this. It feels well made. I mean, it's a big company. It's a well-known company. The matte finish on this looks really nice. I like the shape. The spout's pretty good. To control it, you've got a dial that will set your temperature. I'm going to set ours again to 95. And in the middle of this, there's a little button that will set things going. There is, as usual, a hold button, as well as a Celsius Fahrenheit setting as well. Let's go. Nice little beep at the end. I like a beep. You can push a button and turn the beep off. That's an option too. But I like a beep. As long as it's a good beep. Now, the buttons on here feel good. The dial feels nice to adjust. It is made with, you know, a good quality build, but to pour with, it feels like it wants to pour fast. Actually, it's quite difficult to kind of have a slower, controlled pour. It doesn't feel quite as easy. The angle of the spout sort of projects the water quite a long way forwards. It's not my favorite to pour with. So the Timemore Smart Kettle is a frustrating thing. As you look at this, you'll see it's a nice little base. It looks very clean. It looks extremely minimal. And you can see there's sort of a couple of things here. Here's a hold button, you know, sort of a light LED underneath. And here's a start-stop button. You can see on here, this is the temperature of the water. It's quite warm in the studio today. And our target temperature is 95. But how do we change our target temperature? Well, like this. You have to sort of run your finger up and down this little board that is not particularly responsive. This is, for me, quite an unpleasant experience. I don't want to stroke my kettle. I don't want to, you know, it's a really odd interaction decision to do. Like, I don't know why? I don't know why. Occasionally it's accurate, occasionally it seems to register nothing at all. I gotta just stroke it just right. Interestingly, you could start it by pushing hold or start and stop, which is sort of interesting. It'll put it into heating mode. A little light comes on. It's nice. It beeps. I'm okay with the beep. And just while it's heating, I'll mention the lid. There's a rubber gasket with little sort of knobbly bits on it too. It's quite hard to seat properly. You know, it just doesn't feel quite right often. And I often found myself having not put it on properly. It just doesn't feel quite right to me. Now, interestingly, once it finishes heating, it just shows you your target temperature, and it doesn't seem to read the live temperature anymore. It says it's holding it there, but it's just not fluctuating. Yeah, really quite nice to pour with. Not bad. Pretty easy to work with. Yeah, okay. I wish the capacity was a little bit bigger, but the handle is good. The spout is pretty good. I have no real complaints about the experience of pouring. All of my complaints really are to do with the base of the unit. So next up is the Felicita Square. Here is the first of the problems. They've chosen to sort of tweak the design a little bit by making the lid on top kind of square shape with kind of rounded corners here. I think there's quite a lot of, you know, say imitation of Fellow's design. The handle feels very Fellow Stagg, but the lid is different. The problem with a square lid, and fans of Pythagoras may already be ahead of the curve on this one, is that when you have a square in an opening like this, it means that there is a gap longer than the sides of the lid, which means it's relatively easy to accidentally drop the lid into the kettle, right? Like it goes in just really easily. It just fits. A square is a bad lid design. It's that simple. Do not make your lid square. Circles work really well, right? You can't get the lid into the kettle no matter how hard you try. Here, with very little work, just in, and that's bad. So let's look at the rest of the build. The design is relatively simple. Everything is really conducted through two buttons on a dial. There's just a large sort of shelf space here with the brand name on. I feel like that's a weird use of real estate. The dial itself isn't great. It works fine. It just doesn't feel particularly well made. There's quite a lot of play in it. It doesn't feel beautifully machined. It feels cheap. And this is £125. And so it just doesn't feel to me quite like it achieves that premium price. To use, turn it on, set your temperature, and it's easy to do, you know. A little gear icon flashes while it's setting, and once you've left it alone for a couple of seconds, it kicks on and begins to heat. It beeps when it ends, and I'm a fan of that. I like to be reminded when my kettle is done, especially if there isn't going to be an obvious kind of boiling moment if I'm aiming for that lower temperature. To pour with, nice. Plenty of control, feels pretty easy to use. No real complaints about the balance or the weighting of this thing. It's not a bad kettle to pour with. It seems to do a pretty good job heating water, though not always very accurately. I don't really have any issues with this. I just wish, again, the base was a little bit better built and a little bit more intuitive, and I wish they'd changed the lid design, and then I think you'd have a good little kettle at that point. So next up is the Bonavita. It's a bit further away this way because the cable's quite short, which is actually a bit of a negative for me. I want a slightly longer cable in my stuff for flexibility, but that's a small nitpick. Features-wise, pretty simple. It's got the kind of classic setup that you've seen on something like the Diguo, though I think the Diguo is most definitely inspired by this one here. So on-off button, your temperature flashes, you can cycle through with your sort of temp set button. Leave it be for a second, it'll flash, and then when you've done nothing, it'll click on. You've got your Celsius Fahrenheit choice and your hold button as well to keep it held at that particular temperature if that's what you want. No beep when it reaches temperature, so you just have to be paying attention or leaving it in hold mode, which is obviously much less energy efficient to keep it kind of heating until you remember that you boiled a kettle. Anyway, let's pour with it. It is nice to pour with. It feels very easy to control. All of those things that you want from a pouring kettle are there. It sort of pours in an expected way. It's not surprising or odd or awkward or anything like that. The little finger holder in the handle, I don't know how I feel about it. Like, there's a little space for your sort of index finger, but it's not like an issue. It's not like I couldn't use this because that thing winds me up or something like that. It's just an interesting design choice to me. So the Brewista is an interesting kettle to me. It's the biggest, it's 1.2 liters, but it has a minimum fill level of 500 milliliters, which is a little big. Sometimes I don't need that much water and I don't want to boil that much water, and so having to boil at least 500 milliliters is a negative. It's a little bit wasteful, ultimately. In terms of controls, there's no real kind of physical buttons. You're just touching sort of icons under glass, but it does a couple of interesting things that are worth mentioning. Firstly, it has a just boil button, like a rapid boil. Don't be smart, don't try to be clever, just element on until 100 degrees Celsius. I like that. I think that's useful. It has a timer function where if you were trying to time a pour over, you know, you might have a set of scales that don't have a timer on them. You might not want to use scales, but But why would you not use scales? You've got a heat button for just kind of go, bang in the middle, though it's not the most intuitive icon to me in some ways. Next to it is a button that confused me. It's an A with a sort of circle around it. And if I have to break out a manual to use a kettle, have you made it too complicated? A kettle should be a relatively simple thing. It should be an intuitive thing. And I really initially had no idea what this was. And I don't really enjoy reading manuals. I try to. But the manuals they write, I will say, I think I've complained about Brewista manuals a little bit before. They're quite dense and not particularly intuitive to me. Anyway, complaints aside, it's an auto start button, right? So you set the time on the unit, you set your desired brew time, I guess, and then 8 minutes beforehand, it will boil a kettle and hold it at your desired temperature so that you can come down in the morning and you've just got a freshly boiled kettle. Assuming you live a very routine life, to the minute almost, because I really dislike the idea of holding water for 5 or 10 or even 20 minutes at a temperature. It's just very wasteful. So it's not necessarily a feature I'd recommend. It's quite a quick, powerful kettle. I would just come down and put it on and start weighing coffee, grinding coffee, doing that stuff while it boils. It's a strange additional feature. And then you've got your buttons to set the temperature. As you saw there, I struggled a little bit to hit the buttons. I don't love the absence of physical buttons, right? I like something to know that I've pushed that isn't just a beep. It beeps, quite a lot of beep, perhaps too much beep, but still a beep. The final nitpick on the base unit is the display. I wish it was a bit bigger and a bit brighter compared to all the other stuff around it, because sometimes you just want to see the information that's changing and that is updating, that is important to you. This is nice to pour with. Really nice control, you know, nice flow from the spout. Really quite a pleasant experience. Balance-wise, it feels okay. It's a big kettle, and certainly if this was full, I don't know when you'd need a liter of water for a pour over, but if you did, that would be quite hard work to work with, because it is big. But really, to pour with, that stream control, super easy. It's a very nice kettle to make coffee with. So the Hario kettle. It's so expensive. Anyway, it has a couple of behaviors that I think are a little bit weird in terms of how you use it. Firstly, when you cycle through the settings in terms of your preset temperatures, it cycles down, not up. So you start at 100 and you cycle down to 50 in degrees of 10, which is different to how everyone else does it, where they sort of cycle you from the bottom and kind of up. Also, you can't set it at 97, 98, or 99 degrees Celsius. It's 96, 95, whatever, but that or 100. When you're in programming, it'll just keep flashing like this. And the other kettles, once you've left them alone, will kick on for you. Confusingly, on this one, you have to push the power button again, which feels like what you do to turn it off. Right? You push power to turn it on, then you push power again to make it go. That's just not an intuitive behavior to me. That's just a weird thing to want me to do. As it's heating, this little LED goes orange, and when it gets to your ideal temperature, it goes green. Pouring with this kettle is different. The angle of the spout is really quite different. It feels like it's reaching forwards almost into your brew, and I do kind of like it. This spout performed very well in the testing. It's a very easy to control spout. Now, I guess this is the electrified version of a kettle that Hario have made for a really long time. They've got some pedigree in terms of making pouring kettles, and I think this one is, I'm hesitant to say it, but it is kind of the nicest one to pour with. Controlling the flow is really easy. The quality of flow is very good. The angle of the spout is different to the others, and that might really put you off if you've never used a kettle like this and you're used to the other style, but I do quite like it. It is a nice kettle to pour with. It's just so much money. So last up is the Stagg kettle, and if you watch this channel, then you'll know I've had this kettle, I've used it a lot, it's been on the channel for a while. I'm pretty familiar with it, and I certainly like it. The base, the whole thing actually feels really nicely made, it's quite intuitive to use. You've got a small display, and you've got a kind of click wheel on the side here. On the back, you've got your hold switch and your Fahrenheit or Celsius switch. Obviously, we're going to leave in Celsius. And to use it, push the button to turn it on. You can scroll around to your desired temperature, let's say 95, and that's kind of it. Now, in terms of weird behaviors, not much. There's no beep when you get to the right temperature, but if you set it to 100 degrees Celsius, when it gets to 100, it seems to keep trying to keep going a little bit. It seems to keep pulling power, and I don't really understand why, as if it's trying to overshoot, but because you can't make water hotter than 100 degrees Celsius at sea level, it can't sort of overshoot to the point where it fully clicks off. It's kind of a weird one. It's fine, it clicks off with all the other temperatures, but 100, it seems to kind of keep going. Anyway, pouring. because it has that much sort of slower flow rate, it's a much more restricted neck, it's very easy to pour kind of a slow controlled pour with this thing. So for pour overs, it's quite intuitive and easy to use. Like I said, at sort of a very low max flow rate, it can be frustrating for other applications, but for a pour over, really very pleasant. So one more thing, a little Easter egg in this. If you flick your Celsius Fahrenheit switch backwards and forwards, it brings up a kind of snake clone called Wormy that lets you get your worm to chase around the screen and eat the fellow logos. Yeah, that's a thing that exists. But overall, as a pour over kettle, yeah, it's very nice, it's very easy to pour with. Okay, so time for a summary. And as you might guess, there's not gonna be one singular winner. There would be one that might suit you the best depending on your needs for a kettle. But let's start at the beginning. The Diguo, the cheapest one by far, and you really feel that. It's not very well made. I wouldn't have great hopes for its longevity. The whole ergonomics of it are quite poor and it doesn't pour particularly well either. So of the sort of eight here, I probably wouldn't recommend this. I know it is cheap, but you can sort of see why it's cheap. The Dualit is okay. I don't have anything really particularly negative to say about it. The build is pretty good. It's a well-known established brand. It's a decent kettle for a reasonable amount of money, I guess. The Timemore, you know, your frustrations may not mirror mine, but I found the base on this pretty frustrating. The kettle itself is a good little kettle to pour with, to make a coffee with, but I just wish they'd fix the base. The Felicita, again, the lid thing maybe bothers me way more than a normal person. Doing this for a living kind of has broken my mind, I suspect. The build of the base is a kind of problem for me. The kettle itself is okay, bar the lid. The Bonavita feels like one of the kind of benchmarks in this group here, right? It does what it does, it's pretty simple. They've been around for a long time. It works well, it pours nicely. It's okay money. It's a reasonable kettle. The Brewista I like quite a lot, but its minimum fill is actually a really bit of a downside for me. But across many applications, if I was making tea, if I was making a French press, if I was making a pour over, again, it's one of those kettles that is pretty useful across all of those. I think you're paying for some features you may not want to use, and that may put you off a little bit, but I think it's a good kettle. The Hario, I think, is a really good kettle. It's a great kettle. I think the base is okay, and if you just got used to the quirks of it, I think you'd be fine. But I think it pours really nicely. I think it's probably my favorite to make coffee with. It doesn't make better coffee, none of these make better coffee, but I like making coffee with it probably the most. But I can't justify that price. And even 150 euros, that's just a little bit spendy. And the fellow, again, it's a lot of money. It's 150 pounds in the UK, and that is a lot of money. You know, it does everything you need it to do and kind of no more, which is, you know, a good thing. I don't want to pay for features I don't use. If I had this at home though, it wouldn't be right because I need a kettle that has a faster flow of water. And that for me is a deal breaker at home. Here in the studio, yeah, I'll probably keep it. There'll be a new one of these going to a Patreon supporter because they give me a budget every month to go and buy these things and review them. And then I give them away at the end of it because I like that, it makes me happy. So have I come to a winner? I'm not sure I have. You know, if I was brewing pour overs regularly and just pour over for me or maybe me and one other person, then I might lean towards something like the Stagg. If I was brewing for bigger brews or I needed faster flows, I might lean towards something around here. If money was no object and I wanted the nicest possible experience for pouring from my kettle, then I would be tempted by this, but I just wish it was cheaper. But now I'd like to hear from you. Leave me a comment down below. Do you own one of these? Have you found a quirk that I didn't? Have you had a different experience to me, or has your experience matched mine? I'd love to hear from you down in the comments below. But for now, I'll say thank you so much for watching, and I hope you have a great day.